The Paul Klamper brake, one of the blingiest components you can put on your bike, but is it any good as a brake? Is it worth it? Find out in this video. Welcome back, Pathless Peddlers, and if you're new to the channel, if you are into the non-competitive side of cycling, gravel exploring, riding party pace, you have found your people, hit that subscribe button. So the Paul Klampers are just one of those shiny bits that you see on a lot of custom bikes, but there's actually very little information on how well they brake and if they're worth it. If you're not familiar with the Paul Klamper, it is a cable actuated brake. It comes in both flat mount and post mount and has different lever arms that you can change on the caliper body depending on what kind of brake lever you're using. So there are options for short pull, long pull, campy. And what this means is you can buy one pair of caliper bodies and use it both on your road bike, on your mountain bike, or your bike with campy levers. The design language is classic Paul components, so kind of boxy and utilitarian, but with a really nice finish and also offered in some fun anodized colors. The brake calipers have a strong spring lever arm, as well as easy adjustable knobs to move both the inner and the outer brake pad. And speaking of brake pads, it doesn't use anything exotic, so these are brake pads that you can find in any bike shop. One cool thing about the Paul Klampers is actually how simple it is. They've got a whole video on their YouTube channel disassembling it, and it's remarkable how few parts the brakes actually use. It's almost like a haiku of disc brakes. So lastly, it's hard to not talk about the elephant in the room, and it is how expensive these brakes are. So per caliper, you're looking at about $230. As kind of a frame of reference, the brakes I bought for my Crest Bambora, which are the Yokozuna Ultimos, cost just a little bit less, so $210. So both kind of on the spendier side of the spectrum, but when compared to the Yokozunas, the Paul Klampers aren't actually that much more expensive. I know a lot of you are gonna be wondering, you know, how they compare back to back, and we'll get into that later in the video. So they're shiny, they're expensive. How do they actually ride? I set the brakes up on my Crest Bambora and it took about a week's worth of riding before I felt like the brakes hit their full potential. There is kind of a bedding time with these brakes like any other disc brakes, so you can't judge them immediately after installing them. Probably the most immediate things I noticed was how strong the lever arm was. It gave a nice feedback to the brake levers even when I was running full housing to the rear caliper. They were just snappy and responsive. The brake pads and levers opened up with a nice kind of springy snap to them. There are a few things that I dislike more on a disc brake bike than having spongy levers, and the Paul Klampers are pretty springy. In terms of just pure braking power, after the brakes had fully bedded in, I had no problem bringing the Bambora to a complete skidding halt from the tops. I didn't have to get into the drops, which I found I've had to do with things like the TRP spires. You can easily lock up the bike from the top of the hoods. So I don't know if you need more braking power than that, but personally, I think that's all you really need. I know the next question someone will ask is, how is the brake modulation? This is where I think hydraulics do have a little bit of an edge. So while I feel like I can feather the brakes pretty well, it doesn't have that same kind of hydraulic brake lever feedback, if you know what I mean. Not to say that the brake feel is binary, there is some feathering, but that same brake sensitivity feedback isn't there. So speaking of hydraulic disc brakes, you're probably asking, you know, at this price point, why not just go hydraulic? And for me, one big reason is serviceability. As you guys know, I am constantly changing things on the Crest Bambora. Wide handlebars, short handlebars, different drivetrains, different brake levers, and with hydraulic disc brakes, that would be a complete pain in the butt and probably not even possible with lots of the combinations I've tried on the channel. So if you like to experiment on your bikes, cable brakes, mechanical disc brakes are still the way to go. Okay, so what are the pros and cons of the Paul Klampers? One big pro from a serviceability standpoint, as well as a longevity standpoint, is that you can change the lever arms. I think this is pretty unique to this brake caliper. Yes, they are a big upfront investment, but it's pretty cool that you can move them from your drop bar bike to your mountain bike, and all you have to do is change those lever pull arms. So if there was ever such a thing as a forever brake, these brakes would probably be it. Another big pro is the stopping power. Yes, you can bring your bike to a skidding halt from the top of the hoods, and honestly, I don't think you need more than that. So plenty of stopping power from all the brake positions on the drop bar bike. I know a bunch of you are wondering how they compare to the Yokozunas I love. In terms of pure stopping power, I think they're even, with the big asterisk that the Yokozunas require their special compressionless housing. Without that housing, which isn't cheap, the Yokozunas are average at best. It's actually shocking how different the performance is in the Yokozunas without their compressionless housing. And once you factor in that, roll that housing is about $60. The price per brake with the Pauls is actually about the same. And the Pauls work great with just cheap, regular brake housing. I think the Yokozunas do have an edge in terms of modulation, but that said, that modulation does come at a little bit of a cost in existential doubt. There's a non-serviceable reservoir there, which you can't fix, which bike shops probably can't tinker with. Whereas with the Pauls, you don't have that same hydraulic modulation feeling, but the mechanics are dead simple and there's no existential doubt that you're gonna break anything or can't service it. So both brakes are great brakes. But in terms of longevity, I totally expect the Paul Klamper brake to outlast the Yokozuna. All right, so what are the cons of the Paul Klampers? So one big con is the boxy aesthetic. It's not for everyone. I tend to like it. But on a more practical note, its larger caliper design doesn't play well with all rotors or with frames with really tight clearances. So definitely something to be aware of when considering these brakes. And of course, the price, these brakes are not inexpensive, but when you compare them to the other brake I love, the Yokozuna Ultimos, which are about $210 a caliper and require special housing, the price kind of evens out. And again, going back to that longevity and simplicity in servicing the brake, I definitely expect the Paul Klampers to outlive the Bambora and be moved to multiple bikes in the future. So that is definitely one thing to consider. If you're on a budget and you just need something to adequately stop your bike, there are definitely more inexpensive options. But if you want to invest in a brake that's going to outlast your current bike and probably the bike after that, as well as support a small US manufacturer, then the Paul Klampers are definitely a brake to consider. And I honestly do think that the value is there, especially when you factor in serviceability, the fact that you can upgrade the lever arms, the fact that there are such few parts to brake. I feel like a lot of brake levers are almost disposable, but these are definitely made to last. So would I recommend them? Heck yeah, if you can afford it, definitely go for it. Would I personally buy a pair? If I'd known how well they stopped and also all the other great features in terms of serviceability, probably would have purchased these brakes over the Ultimos. But that's what I think. Let me know what you think. Are any of you guys out there running the Paul Klampers? Let me know your experiences in the comments below. And as always, keep the supple side down.